you, we give you thanks, we sing our song of praise. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. Jesus, Savior of all, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away our sins, O Lord, have mercy on us all. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. At the Father's right hand, Lord, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, and you alone are the Lord. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. In excelsis Deo, glory Father and Son, glory Holy Spirit, to you we raise our hands up high, we glorify your name. Gloria, Gloria, in excelsis Deo. Gloria, in excelsis Deo.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Reading 1 Kings 19th chapter. The Lord said to Elijah, you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah, as prophet to succeed you. Elijah set out and came upon Elijah, son of Shaphat, as he was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen. He was following the 12. Elijah went over to him and threw his cloak over him. Elisha left the oxen, ran over to Elijah and said, please let me kiss my father and mother goodbye and I will follow you. Elijah answered, go back. Have I done anything to you? Elijah left him and taking the yoke of oxen, slaughtered them. He used the plowing equipment for fuel to boil their flesh and gave it to his people to eat. Then Elijah left and followed Elijah as his attendant. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Keep me safe, O God. You are my hope. Except in you. be safe, O God. You are my hope. You are my hope, O God. I find in God always my cup of joy, and God will keep my life secure. Keep me safe, O God.
Our epistle is from St. Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 5. Brothers and sisters, for freedom Christ set us free. So stand firm and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. For you are called for freedom, brothers and sisters, but do not use this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. Rather, serve one another through love. For the whole law is fulfilled in one statement, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you go on biting and devouring one another, beware that you are not consumed by one another. I say then, live by the Spirit, and you will certainly not gratify the desire of the flesh. For the flesh has desires against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. These are opposed to each other, so that you may not do what you want. But if you are guided by the Spirit, you are not under the law. These are the words of the God, of the Lord.
Thank you.
Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. You have the words of everlasting life. The Lord be with you. The Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory.
When the days for Jesus being taken up were fulfilled, he resolutely determined to journey to Jerusalem. He sent messengers ahead of him. On the way, they entered the Samaritan village to prepare for his reception there. But they would not welcome him because the destination of his journey was Jerusalem. When the disciples, James and John, saw this, they asked, Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to consume them? Jesus turned and rebuked them. They journeyed to another village. As they were proceeding on their journey, someone said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus answered him, foxes have dens and birds of the sky have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to rest his head. And to another he said, follow me. But he replied, Lord, let me go first and bury my father. But he answered him, let the dead bury the dead. But you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. And another said, I will follow you. I will follow you, Lord, but first let me say farewell to my family at home. To him Jesus said, no one who sets a hand to the plow and looks at what was left behind is fit for the kingdom of God. These are the words of the Holy Gospel. They're the words of eternal life.
Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today I want to talk about accepting Jesus' call. What does that mean? What does that mean for us? What are we supposed to do about it? That's what our gospel message is about today. I've mentioned Dietrich Bonhoeffer before, and I did want to mention him again because this is a good place to talk about one of his ideas. He was a German theologian in the 20th century, and he had this contrast that he developed between what he called cheap grace and costly grace. Cheap grace is we receive God's grace. We receive God's love and forgiveness. We receive God's support. We don't have to do anything. We just stay as we are. Everything is the same as it was before as far as we're concerned, except now we have God's grace to support us. Costly grace is different. We receive God's grace and we realize that we have to change. Something about us has to become different than it was before. We have to make a commitment. And that's what Jesus is talking about in the gospel today. Jesus asks for a commitment from us. It is true that grace and forgiveness are freely given to us by God. We don't deserve them, and yet we receive them anyway. That's true. But Jesus does ask something from us. He asks us to be committed to our faith. Now, from our perspective, if we're not really committed, it's not a real faith. If we go on as before, if everything is the same as it was before, our faith isn't real. And that is what Jesus asks of us. He asks us to make that commitment. In our Old Testament reading today, we see kind of a prelude to what we see in the gospel message today. This is a story about Elisha, who became the successor to Elijah the prophet. This is in 1 Kings chapter 19. And the story of which you just heard, what I want to say about it is pretty simple. Elisha gives everything up to follow God's command. The Lord said to Elijah, this is from 1 Kings chapter 19, you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat of Abel Moloah, is a prophet to succeed you. And so Elijah goes and finds him and says, come on. And Elisha gives everything up. He says he left him, taking the yoke of oxen that he had, slaughtered them, and used the plowing equipment for fuel to boil their flesh. He gave it to his people to eat. Then Elisha left and followed Elijah as his attendant. Elisha left all behind to follow God's command. That's a model, and it's a model that's directly referred to in the New Testament today. Jesus, in Luke chapter 9, says, no one who sets a hand to the plow and looks to what was left behind is fit for the kingdom of God. You have to be willing to leave everything behind, all the other things that you valued before, everything that seemed important, has to become of secondary importance to accept Jesus' call. In our New Testament reading, our epistle today was from Galatians chapter 5. What do we get, right? I mean, this is not really a rational calculation. It's not an economic calculation. But, what happens to us? This commitment that we get is true freedom. This is kind of a paradox, right? It's a paradox that we make a commitment that we accept the yoke of Christ and that this in itself is freedom to us. And that's what Paul is saying here. Paul is saying, for freedom, Christ set us free. So stand firm and do not submit again to the yoke of slavery. Instead, we accept this yoke of Christ, this is the main glossary, and that yoke is true freedom. The yoke of slavery, the yoke of being what we were before, is not accepting that commitment. But when we follow Christ, we're truly free. We're free from sin. Our sins have been forgiven. We're free from the burden of the law. Because this again is a special concern of Paul's. The law can't save us. We can't follow the law well enough to be saved. The only thing that can save us is Jesus Christ. We're free from that burden of everything before, and all we accept is this yoke of Christ, which we hear about in the Gospel, Luke chapter 8, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. We can accept this commitment with joy and gratitude, because it's this yoke of Christ that sets us free. It's this yoke of Christ in which our salvation consists. It does ask for a commitment from us. We do have to do something. We do have to be different than we were before. And I will say too, and I think everybody who reflects on it has experienced this, this is something that's a continual effort. It's something that we have to do and then renew again and again, because we're people. We're just not perfect. I mean, I know I'm not. And so I have to remember this and go, oh yeah, this has to be first, right? Because it's so easy to forget. We get caught up in the concerns of life. We get so caught up in the things that are going around us, which can be very pressing and demanding. We can get totally distracted from what's most important of all, which is our commitment to Christ. There is nothing more important than that. But it's just so easy to forget that. So often we have to turn again to Christ and renew our commitment to Him. But He does expect a commitment from us. And that's really the big point I wanted to make today. In our gospel message today, Luke chapter 9, which we just heard, Jesus and his disciples are traveling, and they encounter various people who say, I'll go where you go. And, it's an interesting passage where Jesus says, foxes have dens and birds of the sky have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to rest his head. This is an open-ended commitment. That's what Jesus is saying there. He's saying, I'm going to do what I have to do. There's not a place where he gets to rest and stop, where it's all over, where he's at home even. He's just going and doing what he has to do. It's an open-ended commitment that he makes. And that's what he's telling the people who ask him this. I'll go where you go. Okay, come along. Okay? But there's not a place where we get to stop and rest. Another one, I have to let me bury my father. And basically he's saying, let me go home and take care of business. Whenever I'm ready, then I'll make that commitment. And, that's not it. Jesus answered, let the dead bury their dead. You go and proclaim the kingdom of God. That's what is first. The other stuff is second. The other one, I've got to go say farewell to my family at home. Right? Again, I've got to go take care of business. And, Jesus says, as I read a minute ago, no one who sets a hand in the plow and looks for what was left behind is fit for the kingdom of God. All that other stuff is of secondary importance. And that's what we're talking about here. That's what's so hard to do, because everything gets up in our way, and this is what's going on right this minute. And it's just so easy to forget about what is most important of all. That's why we have to reorient ourselves occasionally. In my case, regularly, I have to go, wait a minute, this is, the other stuff is not what's important. This is what's most important. We don't have to be a heroic figure. I've told you all about Bonhoeffer before. You've probably heard of him. He was a heroic figure. He wound up being executed in a concentration camp by the Nazis as a spy, which he actually was. And spy for the Allies, but he wound up being executed for doing what he knew to be the right thing. We don't have to be a hero like that. I mean, for someone like that, that's a wonderful example for us to try to follow. In his case, he made a commitment to his faith, and he was willing to go to his death because of his commitment to his faith and to do what he knew to be the right thing. But even though we don't have to be heroes, Jesus does ask us to make a commitment. And look what he's already given us. He's already given us our salvation. All we have to do is accept it. The way we accept it is to make that commitment to Him. When we accept that commitment and go where Jesus leads us, that means real freedom for us. That means we get everything, everything, all in exchange for a commitment to Jesus Christ. Amen. Confession of faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, only made with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, He is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen. I want to mention before we continue, we meant to say it during the homily, I forgot, but I want to say thanks to Robin and Tom for the wonderful things that have been done to the floor and the bathroom there. It's just beautiful. It's just absolutely beautiful. And I was telling Tom before we began today, what a sense of gratitude I have whenever y'all do anything like that. Whenever y'all do stuff for the church, I'm just blown away, you know? And everybody here has done things, you know, with one kind or another. And this is what happened just now. And it's just so beautiful. But I'm just always, I never cease to be surprised and amazed that when y'all do something, that's that kind of commitment to Christ. I mean, it just is. When y'all do things for the church, you're doing things on behalf of God. I mean, it's not on behalf of me. You know, it's on behalf of Christ. And it's beautiful. It's wonderful. And it really does give me a sense of deep gratitude and happiness whenever y'all do anything like that. I'm just really grateful. Thank you.
Peace from above and by salvation, let us call upon the Lord.
Hear us, Lord God.
For peace on earth, for the integrity of the churches of God, and for the unity of all Christians, let us call upon the Lord.
Hear us, Lord God.
For this house sanctified to Him and for all who enter here with devotion, faith, and fear of God, let us call upon the Lord.
Hear us, Lord God.
For our Bishop Maurice, for all the bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the faithful and all people that will, let us call upon the Lord.
Hear us, O Lord God.
For our people and their governments, let us call upon the Lord.
Hear us, O Lord God.
For this city and state and for its people, let us call upon the Lord.
Hear us, O Lord God.
For the health of the earth, the water, and the air, and above all the peaceful times, let us call upon the Lord.
Hear us, O Lord God.
For those who are traveling, for the sick and the needy, for the mourners and the afflicted, for the imprisoned, let us call upon the Lord.
Hear us, O Lord God.
Let us be free from all misery and anger, affliction and distress, let us call upon the Lord.
Hear us, O Lord God.
We also pray for our country. God watch over those in heaven and protect us, that we live a beautiful life in pride and honor. Let us call upon the Lord.
Hear us, O Lord and God.
Communion and reverential remembrance of the Blessed Virgin Mary and of all the saints, let us give ourselves and our own life to Christ, our Savior.
To you, O Lord.
Lord our God, your power knows no bounds, your glory exceeds our understanding. Your mercy knows no measure, and your love for humanity is immeasurable. Look upon us in this holy house and show us and all who pray with us your mercy and your compassion. For you deserve all glory and honor, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, now and always, and forever and ever.
Amen.
God, Heavenly Father, giver of all good gifts, who gave the bread for us to eat and the wine to drink, that he might bring joy to the heart of man. By the example and direction of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, we lay down these precious gifts of your goodness on the altar and hold them ready for the holy sacrificial day. In them, we sacrifice ourselves to you and your whole world with this wheel of love. Take hold of our humble hearts and look mercifully upon all your creation, sighing and struggling after you. So come, you who enliven and sanctify everything, Almighty, eternal God, and bless this sacrifice prepared for your holy name. Pray, brothers and sisters, that our offerings have pleased the Lord our God.
The Lord has accepted our sacrifice for the praise and glory of his name. Our opposition and our lives are to the Holy Church.
Lord our God Almighty, you alone are holy. You accept the sacrifice of praise from those who call to you wholeheartedly. Accept our prayer and let it reach your heavenly altar. Let your good spirit of grace descend upon us, these gifts, and your holy people. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, to whom you are praised, together with your all holy, good, and living spirit, now and always, forever and ever.
Amen.
O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is worthy and right.
It is indeed right and a good and joyful thing that we should thank you always and everywhere, O Father and Lord Jesus Christ. We your blessing, and we accept your presence, and we offer you our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to the praise and glory of your name. Amen. Like us, they all belong to you in their faith and devotion. We pause in Holy Communion in honor of the memory of Mary, the Blessed Mother of the Redeemer, and all the apostles, martyrs, and confessors of the faith, whose word, example, and prayer you've left blessed among us all and for us all through Christ our Lord. Send us, we humbly ask you, your Holy Spirit, the giver of all life and all sanctification. Let these gifts of the earth be consecrated to heavenly, transfigured offerings. The bread which we break is the communion of the body of the Lord. And the cup cup that we bless is the communion of the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. For on the day before his suffering, he took the bread, his holy and venerable hand, raised his eyes to you, O God, his almighty Father, thank you, blessed, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, all of you, for this is my body, which is given for you. In the same way, after the meal, he also took the cup in his holy and venerable hands, thanked you again, blessed, and gave it to his disciples and said, take and drink from this, all of you, for this is the cup of the new and eternal covenant, my blood shed for you and for me, for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this in remembrance of me.
Bye.
take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
And let's pray together. O God, merciful Father, hear us through the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant us forgiveness of sins. We humbly ask you that we who share in this holy meal may worthily receive the body and blood of our Lord, and that we may, with your grace and heavenly blessing, become one with him in spirit, that he dwell in us and we in him. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, throughout all ages, world without end. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world.
O Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter my room, but speak only one word, and my soul will be healed.
Come, everything is ready.
Sacred silence, holy ocean, gentle water washing over me. Help me listen, Holy Spirit. Christ my brother, Holy Spirit sanctifying me. Lord, I'm sorry, please forgive me. Come and set me free. Sacred silence, holy ocean, gentle water washing over me. Help me listen, Holy Spirit. Come and speak to me. Holy Mary, gentle mother, God's pure vessel, saints and angels, all in heaven, come and be with me. Sacred silence, holy ocean, gentle water washing over me. Help me listen, Holy Spirit, come and speak to me.
Let's pray together. what we receive with our mouths, O Lord, let us be pure in our hearts, so that your temporal gift may lead us to eternal salvation. So stay in us, banish from us every thought of evil, since we are so refreshed with your pure and holy sacrament. Thank you and praise to you in all eternity. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Lord, our God and Father, in this Eucharistic celebration, you have given us the word and body of your Son to make us a community of love and service. May he be our strength to liberate those who suffer from exploitation and fear, that we may all be free in Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us all praise the Lord.
Praise and thanks be to God.
Blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen. Let us go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Let's stand together now and turn to number 250.
I have heard you.
wonderful week, everyone. Play ball.
I have peace.